Hello out there, we're on the air, it's hot and nice tonight. Tension grows, the whistle blows, and the puck goes down the ice. The goalie jumps and the players bump and the fans all go insane. Someone roars, Bobby scores at the good old hockey game.
Oh! Well, there's our intro for our before our hockey presentation. So the library board, as everybody knows, tries to create an interest and bring different things to the library so people will come out for the very first time in their life to the library. And just different interest aspects that people might have. So what we discussed at the board was talking about the life of an NHL hockey player. And so we viewed that, thought we would talk to a wife of an NHL hockey player and a loud, avid mom of an NHL hockey player. So Marilyn and I have put out different memorabilia on the table for people to look at if they want to, and just to go along with our little presentations. So a day in the life of an NHL hockey player as viewed by a mom. Now as parents, we all know how hard it is when it's time for our children to leave home. But to have to let a child leave home at the age of 14 is sometimes a little harder to do than what I was ready for. In 1997, Nick left home to go play AAA hockey for the Yorkton Maulers. He played there for 1 year, and he was very fortunate to play with two other players from the Strasbourg minor system, Tom Herman and Mike Wuerl. Nick was chosen to play in an all-star game and was the youngest player at the age of 14 playing with the 16 and 17-year-olds. After the game was over, Nick received the MVP of the game, top defender, and the Scholastic Award for the AAA League. In 1998, it was his NHL Bantam draft year. He was picked by the Prince Albert Raiders. He made the team at the age of 15, and he played there for 3 years. One of those seasons, he was very fortunate because he had two more Strasbourg minor hockey players with him, his cousin Jesse Schultz and Mike Wuerl. Nick was captain of the Raiders for his very last year, and at the end of the season, he was named the Raiders' top defenseman and the most improved player. His grade 12 year in 2000, Nicholas, at the age of 18, attended the NHL draft in Calgary. He was accompanied by Robert Nye, his brothers Chris and Terrence, and his sister-in-law Carla, his very best friend Casey Hines, and his cousin Jesse Schultz. Nick was chosen 33rd overall by the Minnesota Wild. He made that team in 2001 at the age of 19. He played for the Wild for 10 years, a total of 748 games, and was later traded to Edmonton Oilers in 2012. While he was with the Wild, he was named captain twice throughout the term, and he was assistant captain for 4 or 5 of those other years. When he was finished his term with the Oilers, he was traded to the Columbus Blue Jackets in 2013, and in 2014, Nick became a Philadelphia Flyer. On January the 13th of this year, Nicholas played in his 1,000th hockey game with the NHL. A milestone that only 300 players have actually made. Nicholas, during his career with playing hockey, represented his province and the country. In 1999, Nick played in the Canada Winter Games and represented Saskatchewan. During his junior career, he played in the World Juniors representing Canada, 1 year in Prague and another year in the Czech Republic. And there they won the bronze and silver medals. In the early years of his NHL career, when a player's team is out of playoffs, players can be picked up to go and play for Team Canada at Worlds. Nick played for the Team Canada for 3 years, winning gold twice for Canada, which that is the jersey that he would have wore. I thought I had some medals, but I guess I've left my house, so. During his NHL career, he was involved in two hockey lockouts. One lockout lasted one entire year, and at that time, In 2005, he left and went and played hockey in Kassel, Germany for the year. The second lockout was only for half a year, and he played out the rest of the NHL season that year for the Oilers. During his playing career, Nick has sustained a very healthy lifestyle and missed a handful of games due to a concussion and a bulging disc in his neck. In 2007, he had ruptured appendix where he missed three games, but was back on the ice for a couple of playoff games before the team was eliminated. During the hockey season, Nick, Jessica, and their three children, Jake, Brooke, and Sydney, live in Haddonfield, New Jersey, which is just a short little drive over a bridge to Philadelphia. His playing career to this point in a little bit of a nutshell. Now, as a mother and a parent of a son playing in the NHL, there's definitely a lot of pride. But I have no more pride for Nicholas being an NHL player than I do have for my other two sons, Christopher and Terrence. That wonderful game of hockey has brought many lifelong friendships to me with Marilyn, Deb, Vicky, all of us that have been there cheering and excited in a hockey game. We've traveled around to many rinks, shared burgers, we've cheered, some of us still cheer, slap, grab knees, whatever it takes. And also, it's a great conversation piece for young and old alike, no matter where you are, when you want to talk the game of hockey. But with this career, I do say with sadness that my son left home at a very early age, was made to grow up, take care of himself, and become a man at a very young age. I am proud of how Nick, how he matured and looked after himself. As many young players and their parents always, or at times, seem to lose sight of the realistic chance that they might make it to the show. And making it to the show, what that can do to a hockey player as a person. First of all, I was told, probably from my husband and my three boys, that it's every little boy's dream to make it to the NHL. So, when the hockey people start noticing you and telling you that, boy, you're gonna go places, that he's really good, this is where we as parents are needed to help keep this player grounded. Because just because you're a good player in Strasbourg, or you do good in AAA, or you maybe you have some success in junior, and you could possibly be in the NHL, this is a big world out there. And there's thousands and thousands of other hockey players that are being told that very same story. So when that dream became a reality, your life changes instantly. Nicholas, as a young boy, and now is a very dedicated, determined, hardworking person. He knows he never can quit conditioning or training. It's a daily routine in his everyday life. Proper nutrition and care of his body is very critical. As Nick's mom and a family, there have been sacrifices. We have only celebrated three Christmases altogether as a family since Nick's hockey career began. And one of those Christmases as a family was shared after Robert passed away. As a grandma to his three children, I've been able to only celebrate maybe two or three of their birthdays with them. Jake's 9, Brooke's 7, and Sydney's 5. So that's not a lot of birthday cake that this grandma's got to have yet. All of those years we'll never get back. So yes, it is exciting and it is a thrill to watch my son on TV and to yell and scream in the privacy of my own house. But as the old saying goes, all that glitters is not always gold. As a mother, I am proud of Nick giving back to his community where his hockey career started, here in the Strasbourg rink. Over the years, he has funded over 10 hockey trips for fundraisers for the rink. He has given over $40,000 back from the Players Association to give equipment to the teams here, the plexiglass in the rink, and helped to fund many of different fundraisers throughout the years, the 10 years that we did the Schultz 4-on-4. And probably the biggest accomplishment that I appreciate him for is stepping up for the Zamboni Memorial Fund for his dad and funding the rest of that so that we could have a new Zamboni for the rink. Every year he gives a scholarship to a graduating student at William Derby School. This makes me the proudest of my son. In closing, I am a proud hockey mom of an NHL player, but I am more proud of the person that my son is as an individual. to the people that he knows, to his family and his friends, and most of all to the community where he grew up. That makes me a proud NHL hockey mom. Thank you. So now that we know how a mom reacts, and some of you might have seen me at a hockey game, I'm not sure, but but we've never experienced what it would be like to be an NHL hockey player's wife. So now we're going to do that with Marilyn as she tells us stories of her hockey career.
Oh boy, it's a hard act to follow.
You just don't have as big a mouth as me, that's all.
First of all, I told Carol that right after this, I'm taking a new seminar. And the seminar is called How to Say No. And I'm hoping there's one online I can do tonight. Anyway, thank you all for coming. And I was really apprehensive when Carol first told me about this, and I don't know why I ever said yes, but I did, so, because I don't really like public speaking. But I did.
Is there anybody here you don't know?
What's that?
Is there anybody here you don't know?
Yeah, well. Yeah. Anyways, I had lots of advice. Like once one friend said, "Oh, Marilyn, just have a couple glasses of wine and you won't stop talking." And then my sister-in-law said, "Just picture you guys naked." So I thought the wine was a bad idea. So. Uncomfortable because you guys are all naked and I'm the only one here with clothes on. So I don't know if that makes me feel better or not. But anyways, our journey began when Greg came to Weyburn, where I lived, to play junior hockey. I'm not exactly sure how we ever got together because he was such an athlete and I could hardly walk and chew gum. He was a farm boy and I had never ever been on a farm. It seems like during your hockey career, there's so many major life-changing decisions to make, difficult ones when you were so young especially. And his first choice he had to make was where to play his junior hockey. Following junior, he had a decision to make whether he wanted to go and play for the University of Minnesota Duluth, which he chose with a full scholarship. He lived on campus the first year and was very homesick. We decided to get married during his second year, so he was told he would be living with his family and their two sons. When he arrived there, he said he thought the neighbors must have been over, but found out they actually had six boys. This family was a godsend to us, and they helped us in every aspect. They found us a place to live and got us furniture and like anything we needed, and that was throughout the year. They were just wonderful people, and we have a friendship to this day. I was 17 and he was 19. We thought we were old and we thought we knew everything till that time. And we had a lot to learn. So this family was very helpful. I mean, I didn't even know how to cook a roast or nothing. I was it was not good. So,
are those his words?
No, but I will tell you a quick story about what he said. I made potato pancakes once, his very favorite. His mom made potato pancakes for him every time he came home. So I thought I could make potato pancakes. I got the book out, got the recipe, made it exactly like his mother. Only guess what he said? They don't taste like my mom's. Yeah. He never got another one. Ever. Ever. Except from his mother. So anyway, thanks for bringing that up. So at the end of that season, he got drafted by Montreal, which was a funny thing because he hated Montreal. That was a huge, huge decision for him because he felt such an obligation to stay in Duluth and play because, you know, they were good enough to take him. And anyways, he just really had a hard time deciding whether to stay with his schooling or go to hockey, so of course hockey won. So he that summer he signed, and I remember he was so scared when he went to training camp. I stayed here, he went to training camp, petrified of course, But once he got there, he found, like, the players weren't, all the players that he was so intimidated by, like, they were just so wonderful to him and made the experience mostly positive for him. However, he was sent down to the minors, which was in Halifax. And I stayed here and waited until he found a place for us to live, and then I moved there. Every year for 13 years, we moved twice a year, once going to hockey, once coming home. Every year you meet new players, wives, families, and fans. Our first son was born in Halifax in our second year. Greg was not there for that birth, and of course, very, very sad that he missed it. He arrived a few hours later, got to be home for a few days, and then went on the road for, I don't know, I can't remember, 14 days or something like that. The wives never ever went on any road trips back then. I suppose it's probably a lot different now. I think it'd be a lot different now anyways, because just because of media, you know, back then you couldn't even call long distance because it was too, well, you could call long distance, but you couldn't call as often as you would now, you know, Sundays and after midnight mostly. And however, I did obey the rules always. and our phone bills got a little bit high because I got kind of lonely sometimes. So, you know. And I heard about it. But anyway, at the end of the, at the, where am I here? I lost my space here. Okay, here we go. At the end of the season, he got called up to Montreal for the playoffs. I told you that. Did I read that part?
Nope. No.
Okay. We packed up the kid. I got to go with him because it was at the end of the season and we had to get out of our apartment. So we moved and stayed in a hotel. I can't remember for how many weeks it was. He never dressed for any games, and he didn't even get to practice with them. The players that were called up practiced at different times on their own. So we kind of just hung out and did our own thing. But overall, I think we were treated pretty good, but we never... And in fact, this is a funny thing, he never even got a ticket to go to the games. Isn't that funny? Like, he never got a ticket to go, so yeah. Like, he could have gone if he had paid for the ticket, but... Anyway, I think he would just stay home and watched it on the TV there. Because Greg was a very disciplined and devoted player, all of his coaches highly respected him, and his reputation followed him on every team throughout his whole career, which made many aspects of our life easier. There were always team meetings, autograph signings, fan club functions and fundraisers, which they were expected to attend. Halifax had a very active fan club. We spent 3 seasons there, and then he got a call that he was traded to Toronto that summer, and he was so excited. He trained hard all summer, and as usual, I stayed here waiting to see where we would be moving to. He was over the moon when he made the team. So I packed up our U-Haul and Greg S. Garnet to drive his 5-month pregnant wife and 2-year-old son. Garnet is 17. And
a big life experience.
Yeah, it was huge. And but anyways, and then the transmission went in the car. A lot of things went wrong for this poor 17-year-old kid. And it was a huge responsibility for him. And we were so glad when we got there, but just before we got there, Garnet and I weren't speaking, but then once we saw Greg, everything was okay, and we got, yeah, and then we forgave each other, and kissed and made up. So, and it's such a long, boring drive, and anyway. We soon found out that there was a huge difference between the minors and the majors. Once again, we were blessed to have Tiger and Brenda Williams there to help us find furniture and a house to live, etc. And we have another lifelong friendship. And believe me, there's many stories that go with that, with that friendship. Our second son was born in Toronto, and Greg was there for that birth, which we both were very happy about. Greg was injured in the playoffs that year. It was a huge disappointment. The following 5 seasons were in Dallas. I guess if you have to play in the minors, that was a pretty good place to be. However, there were long road trips there too. Chad was born in Dallas, and Greg was there for that birth.
each and every year we were always having to find apartments and furniture and doctors and dentists and babysitters as well as living for weeks in hotels until moving date. Greg also dressed for one game in Vancouver, which he was pretty excited about that. With every move, there were tears of sadness saying goodbye to family and friends, some you will see again and some not. Meeting new coaches and fans, players and wives every year. Having a career in hockey is hockey and very different experience for each player. Like, we were always lucky because every time we moved, we stayed the whole season, which wasn't always so. I remember when we were in Toronto, there was a player that moved and was told he was going to be there for the year, so he bought a house, which we never ever bought anything, we always rent. But he bought a house and never lived in it. Like, it was like within days he was traded to somewhere else. So we were always lucky that way, so we felt pretty blessed about that. It's not always glamorous. There's a tremendous amount of pressure and stress on the players and their families. There's so many people to please, coaches, teammates, owners, and fans. The press can be very unfair and sometimes cruel. Losing a game, any game, is huge. You will hear about it from them all, and it can easily bring you down. Some of the wives in Toronto never sat in the stands, watched it in the wives' room on TV. They couldn't take the negativity. Greg had some great seasons in Dallas, and as one of the oldest players, was mentor and to many of the young players, getting the nickname Dad. And then they called him Fred for Fred McMurray on My Three Sons. they call him Fred. So, making the decision to retire and move back to try farming, he was asked to coach Junior B in Nipawin. So he packed up again and moved, now being a little bit more difficult as Scott and Chris were in school. Halfway through the season, his old coach, John Muckler, called and asked him to come and finish in the playoffs because he was short defenseman. Honestly, he couldn't pack his bags fast enough. That was not a hard decision, that one was done. He was working at a John Deere dealership and coaching. Coaching there wasn't all that he thought it was going to be. It wasn't a great experience. So anyway, so I moved back here and he went on to Wichita. And then he played a game in Edmonton. The boys and I flew there to watch him play that. And then I went to Wichita for a few days. And that summer he got a call from his agent to play in Switzerland. Well, we all got our passports and we got Chad his Canadian citizenship papers and we're all going to move to Switzerland. And then, you know, we find out that this little town that he lived in didn't have any school and didn't have any English schools and for Scott. And so we didn't want Scott to be behind in his schooling, so we decided to stay here. I'm not sure I would have made that decision now. I think I might have pulled him out of school for a year, but anyway, I didn't. And so, that was a great experience for Greg. But it was a very lonely time for him because you're so far away. And again, you know, you can't just call every day and on the phone. So I'll just read you, if I can get through this, I'm going to read you this little letter that I found, part of it. He wrote this letter to his grandma. Greg was a great letter writer because that's how we communicated, right? And Greg was very good at writing letters. Grandma Lee was sort of his favorite person to write to because she always wrote back and whatever. So he had just come home for Christmas and he's now back there and he's writing her a letter. So he says in this little tissue paper, it was tough to leave Marilyn and the boys. It makes you wonder if it's all worthwhile or not. The boys are all crying and it makes me feel so helpless. It's funny how money seems to rule life, but you can't live without it. I wrote Marilyn and the boys a letter yesterday, and I shall call once a week, so maybe that will help make the time go faster. If our playoffs are decided early, I'll be home the end of February instead of early March.
Tomorrow is the beginning of a new year, and I hope we will be able to spend it as a family from January to December for a change. So, I'm not done yet. But I'm almost done. Okay, I'm almost done. Okay, I got through that. Okay. I put Scott in hockey, of course, when Greg was gone. And I took him to, I remember taking him to this first practice. And I was so worried about dressing him because I didn't know how. And I thought, all these parents are going to look at me like I'm some kind of an idiot. You've been married to a professional hockey player and you don't even know how to dress your kids. So I'd go early and I'd sit beside some dad. And when he put the laugh sock on, I put the laugh sock on. Because I never was in a dressing room and I never saw Greg get dressed. So I didn't know. So anyways, let's see. You know, playing professional hockey certainly has its pros and cons. You miss out on I read you that. Okay. Greg and I often would talk sitting over the years after hockey. And I can assure you that he probably always missed it. But like all his life, he probably always missed hockey. And so we would reminisce and talk about, you know, certain things and, you know, have lots of laughs and sometimes tears and whatever. But overall, we come to the conclusion that even through that, we were blessed to have met so many wonderful friends, been so many wonderful places along the way, that we were grateful that we had the hockey life. And that is that. So, I just wanted to read you a couple little things out of these programs, the short ones. This one is from Dallas. Greg Hubick has been named assistant coach of the Blackhawks. His age, experience, and character made him an excellent choice, said Hawk coach Danny Belisle. In this day and age of hockey, it is only common sense that one coach can't be in all areas of the ice at one time. Some sports have dozens of coaches, and I feel that Greg will be a big help both on and off the ice. The younger players look up to him and he really communicates well with the players. This is the Toronto Maple Leaf program. And here he says, this is what he says when he got there. I never really felt I had a chance with Montreal, he said. When I first found out I'd been drafted, I was happy, but at the same time I was disappointed that it was Montreal. They had so many good players, and I knew it would be a rough lineup to crack. Even at left wing, Hubick was against such talented competition as Murray Wilson, Steve Shutt, Yvon Lambert, and Bob Gainey. I was a little discouraged. I knew I had nothing to look forward to, he said. Still, Hubick, who would be 24 years old on November 12th, was planning to give himself one more season to make the jump to the NHL. If I didn't make it this year, I didn't know what I was going to do. The AHL was no longer a league for older guys, which is 24, who don't quite make it to the NHL. It's more of a development league, and I wasn't sure the Canadians would want to keep me much longer. Maybe I could have gone back and helped my dad on the farm or gone back to school. I was working on a physical education degree in Minnesota. All that is strictly forgotten, maybe now, because Hubick received word during the summer he'd been traded to the Leafs. He greeted the news with jubilation and immediately set out ensuring he'd be in the best physical condition to gain a spot on the Leaf roster. I ran 2, 4, or 6 miles a day, said Hubick, who spent the summer with his wife Marilyn and 2-year-old son on his father's 1,400-acre farm. I knew this was my big chance and I didn't want to blow it. I was really excited. So, and that's good. And the other. So anyway, thanks for listening and thank you very much for coming, and I'll let you know how my seminar makes up.
Thank you.
So in summarizing this little presentation tonight on behalf of Marilyn and I, as everybody knows, everyone knows Nicholas and everyone knew Greg. And they were two individuals that came here from Strasbourg that were no different than any one of us here. They were had an opportunity. They went and they've made the show, I guess is what you call it. But at the end of the day, when it's all over, this is where they came from, and family and friends is what it's all about. So we thank you guys for coming and listening, and there's stuff here to look at if you want to. And if you think we're bragging because we brought it, yeah, we are. But thank you, and we have donuts and refreshments and stuff, and I guess if anybody has questions, you can ask Marilyn. But so thanks, yeah, and you're welcome to. Oh, Dawn.
Actually, I have a question. It was sort of answered in your presentation. Oh. But after 1,000 games, like 1,000 is a lot of games, do you still feel excitement when you're watching them on TV?
Do I feel
excitement? Oh.
That's just because Dawn and Trudy were watched a hockey game with me last night. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. So yeah, so I think that's all. Unless somebody has
what's the biggest difference between, in your opinion, between the NHL then and the NHL now? Like,
it's a few years difference.
Oh,
yeah.
It'd be huge.
Yeah. Yeah. When you said like the wives didn't get to go then, they can't go now.
Yeah.
No. They don't.
They don't go now either.
No, the teams.
They don't.
I think now they train like. When Greg went, your summer was your own. Nick's isn't.
No.
He's trained and training camps are longer, I believe. No.
Yeah. It's
the only thing is with Skype and different things, it's better that way that you can keep contact with your family. Yeah.
You can. Yeah. I think.
Now, well, you can talk every day on the phone.
Yeah.
No matter where you are.
Phone, yeah. Pay the phone bill.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, because now a long distance is like nothing.
Exactly.
Right?
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, that part is your communication is better.
Communication so much better.
Mm-hmm.
So gone.
Yeah. And you had a husband that wanted to talk to you. I have a son that, if I can get him to text me back or call me, God bless me. I've accomplished something.
It depends on whether they won or lost. There was no conversation after a loss.
Yeah.
No.
When you were in Toronto, that was after the first expansion. So probably at the what, early 70s? Mid 70s?
73.
Yeah. So there were probably 12 teams in the NHL at that time.
No, sorry. No, it was not. It was 86. What was it?
76.
Seventy-seven.
There were still probably about 12 teams in the NHL at that
mm-hmm.
time. Has Greg, after that, did he ever show any regrets that there were not 30 teams like there are today, and how many more players would have been up there, and how you have probably been up there for a good part of that career if there were 30 teams?
Yeah, I don't know. He never
talked about that.
Yeah, never said. He just said it's just really hard to get into it. That's all.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just not an easy.
Very, very tough to crack those original.
Like, you know, obviously it was not many, very many teams. It would be even harder to get in, right?
Yeah.
So.
Did Greg have shin pads, or did he just go through a lot of phone books?
He actually had Sears catalog.
Sears catalog.
But I'll tell you, the equipment is a lot different now.
Yeah.
I think when he played in Waverly, I don't even think he wore a helmet.
I know one more thing that's different. I'm sure that we could get to Toronto quicker than we did last
time. Yeah, I think so.
The highway would be better.
Yeah, if a person had more time, there's a million stories, and they're funny, and they're good stories.
But
you know, you just try to summarize everything and
yeah.
Kind of try
so
to put things into perspective.
Yeah.